Catherine Teagan Books and Harper Audio present The Vanishing Stair by Maureen Johnson, performed by Kate Rudd. Where do you look for someone who's never really there? Always on a staircase, but never on a stair. Riddle found on the desk of Albert Ellingham on the day of his death, October 30th. 1938. April 13th, 1936, 9 p.m. Has anyone seen Dottie? Miss Nelson asked. Miss Nelson, the housemistress of Minerva, looked around for an answer to her question. Though it was spring, it was still cold up on the mountain, and the residents of Minerva House were gathered close to the common room fireplace.
Maybe she's with the nurse,
Gertie Van Kuforden said.
Hopefully they'll do something about her sniffing. She's going to make us all sick. It's disgusting. I'm going to be seeing the Astors soon. I can't get sick.
Gertie Van Kuforden was probably the richest student at Ellingham. She had two Astors and a Roosevelt in her family tree, a fact that she managed to work into conversation at every possible opportunity.
Gertrude, Miss Nelson said admonishingly.
No, but really, Gertie said. Now that she's not here, we can say it. She does have the most awful sniff, and she runs her nose along her sleeve. I know we're not supposed to treat them any differently.
Them meant the poor students. The 10 or 11 scrappy people who Albert Ellingham had collected as part of his little game, mix the rich and the poor.
Then do not do so, Miss Nelson said.
Oh, I know she's bright.
An understatement. Dottie Epstein could run rings around the average professor.
But it is awful. I'm merely saying.
Gertrude, Miss Nelson said, sounding tired. That really is enough.
Gertie turned up her nose and shifted her attention to the issue of Photoplay magazine she was reading. From the opposite side of the fire, Frances Josephine Crane, the second richest student at Ellingham Academy, looked up from where she sat. She had made a nest for herself with her chinchilla lap rug and was shifting between a chemistry book and the newest edition of True Detective magazine. And she was watching everything. Frances, like Gertie, was from New York. She was the 16-year-old daughter of Louis and Albertine Crane of Crane Flour, America's favorite. Baking's never a pain when you're baking with Crane. Her parents were fast friends with Albert Ellingham. And when Ellingham opened a school and needed some new pupils, Frances was sent off to Vermont in a chauffeured car, with a van of trunks following that contained every possible luxury. Up here in Vermont, with the snowstorms and the comfortable ratio of obscenely rich and deserving poor, Frances was a settled matter, as far as her parents were concerned. Frances, for her part, was not settled. Her opinion on the matter was not required. Frances, who made it a point to speak to the servants, knew that while Gertie may have been connected in name to Astors and Roosevelts, she was, in fact, the biological daughter of a handsome barman at the Central Park Casino. The casino was where many of New York's rich and bored society women liked to spend their afternoons sipping drinks, and apparently doing other things. Neither Gertie nor Gertie's father knew this. It was a nice little piece of information Frances kept tucked away in her pocket for the right time. There was always a right time for these sorts of things. Frances was rich enough and smart enough to have grown bored of possessions. She liked secrets. Secrets had real value.
No one has seen Dottie?
Miss Nelson asked again, twiddling with her diamond stud earrings.
I suppose I'll call and have someone check the library. She's most likely there and forgot the time.
Frances knew Dottie Epstein was not at the library. She had seen Dottie hurrying into the woods a few hours before. Dottie was a strange, elusive creature, always squirreling herself away somewhere to read. Frances said nothing because she didn't particularly like answering questions, and because she respected Dottie's right to hide herself away if she felt like it. The phone began ringing upstairs in Miss Nelson's rooms, and she rose to answer it. Perhaps it was the moody fog, or the fact that this was later than Dottie would usually stay away. Something pricked Frances's keen sense of potential. She closed her magazine inside of her book and got up from her chair.
"Ooh, give me your rug if you're going to your room," Gertie said. "I don't feel like getting mine."
Frances grabbed the chinchilla with one hand and dropped it on Gertie as she passed. She walked down the dark hall to the turreted bathroom. After locking the door, she pulled off her shoes and socks and carefully stepped on the toilet seat, using it as a step stool to get up onto the windowsill. This was a precarious position. The cold marble sill was only wide enough to accommodate half of her foot, and if she lost her balance, she would fall and crack her head on the toilet or the floor. She had to coil her fingers around the frame of the window and cling. But by doing this, she could get close to a small vent up near the ceiling, and that vent provided a muffled way to listen to the telephone conversations upstairs. Frances tilted her ear to the ceiling and caught bits of Miss Nelson's end. She immediately noted the pitch of Miss Nelson's voice. It was higher, urgent.
"My God," Miss Nelson said. "My God, when?"
Miss Nelson was not prone to drama. She was a controlled woman, well-groomed and attractive and of a certain type, a graduate of Smith who taught biology. She had glossy chestnut hair, always wore the same pair of expensive-looking diamond studs, but otherwise rotated through the same few outfits. Like everyone who taught and worked at Ellingham, she was talented and sharp. And now she sounded afraid.
"But the police?" "Yes, I understand."
"Police?"
"I'll meet you there when the girls are in bed. I'll get them off now. I'll come soon."
The phone went down with a bang, and Frances slipped from her perch and returned to the common room as Miss Nelson came down. She was trying to look casual, but she couldn't help the bright, urgent look in her eye, the flush in her face. She walked to the door and slid the big iron bolt. There was the smallest hint of a shake in her hand.
"Time for bed, girls," she said.
"Where is Dottie?" Gertie said.
"You were right. She's spending the night in the infirmary with the nurse. Now, to bed, to bed."
"It's only 5 to 10, Agnes Renfelt said. "There's a program I want to listen to."
"In your room," Miss Nelson said. "You can listen to your radio there."
Frances went to her room, number 2, at the end of the hall. Once inside, she pulled off her dress and changed into a pair of black wool pants and a gray ski sweater. From the top drawer of her bureau, she removed a candle and a pack of matches, which she put in her pocket. Then she sat on the floor by her door, ear pressed against it, and waited. About 2 hours later, Frances heard Miss Nelson moving past her door. Frances cracked her door slightly and saw Miss Nelson heading toward the stairs at the end of the hall. She looked at the glowing hands of her bedside clock. She would give Miss Nelson a 10-minute start. That would be safe. When the 10 minutes were up, Frances exited her room and went to the spiral stairs at the end of the hall. She worked her way around to the back of the circular stairs. These stairs were enclosed in the back, and this enclosure looked solid, but Frances had discovered the secret of the stairs one night after spying Miss Nelson in the hall. It had taken her weeks to work out the trick of the stairs, but she eventually found that if you pressed on the right spot, a tiny latch would pop out of the bottom. You could use this to pull open a small doorway. Inside the staircase was what appeared to be an empty, tiny bit of storage space. But if you looked carefully, there was a hatch in the floor. Tonight, this hatch was open. Miss Nelson was usually careful enough to close it behind her. The hatch exposed a raw, dark hole in the ground with a ladder that seemed to descend into nowhere. The first time Frances had climbed down, it had taken all her nerve. She had the feel for the ladder now, knowing how to ease her way down into the dark, taking each rung with care. Ball of the foot first, never fully rolling onto the heel until she reached the floor below. At the base of the ladder, Frances found herself in a tight passage made of rough stone. It was only a few inches higher than her head, and just about wide enough for one person, and reminded Frances, not unpleasantly, of a tomb. She managed to pull up her arm and light the candle, and the sulfuric stink of the match filled the space and gave her a small halo of light. She began her walk. Second Ellingham student missing and at large, possibly involved in death of Hayes Major. A Bat Report exclusive, October 15th. There has been a major development in the investigation of the death of YouTube star Hayes Major. Most readers will be aware that Major, famous for his hit show The End of It All, died during the shooting of a video about the Ellingham kidnapping and murders of 1936. While working in a tunnel, he was exposed to a fatal concentration of carbon dioxide. Though the police have declared Hayes Major's death an accident, the result of using a large quantity of dry ice in order to achieve a fog effect for a scene, is the matter settled? An intrepid Ellingham student detective named Stephanie, aka Stevie Bell, launched her own investigation. Bell was admitted to Ellingham as an expert on the 1936 kidnapping case. She became convinced that Major had not placed the dry ice in the tunnel and was in fact killed either by accident or intentionally by another person. Furthermore, she concluded that Major did not write his hit series as he claimed to have done. Bell approached this reporter and asked to review images taken during the day of Major's death. Using information from these photographs, Bell accused fellow student Element Walker of writing the series The End of It All and having a role in the death. Following a confrontation at Minerva House, where Major, Walker, and Bell were all residents, school officials became involved. All remaining students from Minerva House were taken to the Ellingham Great House. What happened next was unexpected and baffling. Sources present at the Great House that night confirm that school officials questioned Element Walker, and that the school opted to stop their questioning to consult with an attorney and to contact law enforcement. Walker was left alone in Albert Ellingham's former office, with the door closed and people right outside. When the door was reopened, Walker was gone and has not been seen since. There are reports that she used a hidden passage in the wall to make her escape. This reporter has to ask, where could Element Walker have gone at night with no supplies, no phone, no car, and no preparation? Ellingham Academy is on a remote mountainside. How did she get away? Did someone on the campus help her? How did she know about the passageway? Was she even involved in Major's death, or did she leave out of alarm? Her disappearance has raised even more questions in this ever-evolving case. Stay with the Bat Report for more exclusive updates. 1. Out of everything in her Pittsburgh neighborhood, the Funky Monkey coffee shop was the thing that reminded Stevie Bell most of Ellingham Academy. It was a 1990s relic with a sign written in a kooky festival font. It had walls painted in bright primary colors, each wall a different shade. It played an obligatory coffeehouse soundtrack of mid-tempo guitar music. There were blown-up pictures of coffee beans and plants and wobbly tables to sit at and oversized mugs. None of these things were features of her previous school. The part she liked, and the part that was like Ellingham, was that it wasn't her house. And when she was here, no one bothered her. Every day this week, she had come and ordered the smallest, cheapest coffee. She would take this to the back of the shop, to a stuffy, small alcove room with red walls. The room was dark and dingy, the tables unbalanced and always a bit sticky. Everyone else avoided it, which is why Stevie liked it. This was her office now, where she did her most important work. If she had tried to do this at home, her parents might walk in. Here, she was in public, but no one actually cared what she was doing or even noticed her. She put her headphones on, but played no music, She needed some muffled silence. She put her backpack on the table, zipper facing her, and opened it. First, she removed a pair of nitrile gloves. These she had purchased at CVS the day she returned. It was probably an unnecessary precaution at this stage.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.